La succession écologique, c'est la colonisation d'un milieu par les êtres vivants.
Ecological succession is the colonisation of an environment by living beings and then a succession of species that will replace each other over time in this environment. In order to understand the influence this can have on biodiversity in the forest, one needs to understand what allows a species to survive in a given environment, in a given place. There are two main factors. First of all, the presence of food needed by the species to survive and reproduce, then environmental factors, temperature, humidity, altitude, which influences the species' performance regarding resource exploitation, and these factors constitute the ecological niche of a species. The ecological niche combines a range of exploited resources, what the species eats as prey, a number of environmental constraints that it can stand, the maximum temperatures or minimum temperatures, and the role played in the forest where it can be found on the ground, on trunks, or in branches, in high branches. We discriminate between the fundamental niche of a species, the theoretical niche, and the realized niche, which is often smaller, more restricted, because this also may depend on the presence of competition. A habitat is a geographical place, one given geographical place, the characteristics of which allow a species to establish a viable population, i.e. to realize its niche. If a given habitat presents the characteristics of the ecological niche of the species, if the species is present as in the form of seeds in the ground, in the soil, or present close by and prepared to colonize the environment, and if locally there are no competitive species, then the species will be able to settle down, realize its niche, and have a viable population on the short term. How can this be expressed in terms of forest succession? Here we're going to talk about primary succession established from bare ground. Initially, there are very few species in presence, and there is strong competition because there are scarce resources in the environment. Only a few species, pioneer species, will be able to settle down because they are not very demanding and they have a strong growing capacity. Later, the pioneer species will die, the individuals will decompose, and their decomposition will enrich the ground, the soil. Because the soil is richer, other species, slightly more demanding, will settle down. This is the post-pioneer stage, and the new species will then constitute new feeding resources for new potential species, creating new habitats, and progressively other species will come and colonize the area following the presence of the initial species. Forest succession is therefore something that depends on the interaction between species. We think about trophic interactions, the presence of prey will allow a predator to survive, but there are other kinds of interactions such as inhibition between species. Some plants will release toxic substances that are toxic for other plants, and there are also facilitation systems. The presence of some species will make it easier for other species to settle down. For instance, pioneer species, which shed a shade on the ground, will allow post-pioneer species to develop because their seeds need to be in shade and cannot develop in sunlight. So pioneer colonization will continue until there are dryad colonization taking place, so the seeds of which need shade to develop. At any stage, there can be something that upsets the process, and the process will go backwards to an intermediate stage. This can be a fire or a storm or something of anthropic origin, for instance, trees being cut down by man. How does this expressed in terms of biodiversity? How do species replace each other in the forest succession? Take the example of plants with their evolution following a period where everything was cut to the ground. At the very beginning of succession, the very first species will be heliophilic. They need sun rays, sunlight to grow. For instance, Digitalis lutea. Subsequently, intermediate species which need less light will colonize the area and the heliophilic species will decline.
Alors que les arbres en grandissant
later, because trees have grown and there is more and more shade, intermediate species will thrive, heliophilic species will disappear, the intermediate ones will start declining, and the cyanophilic species, which like the shade, will start growing. Neotia nidus avus, for instance.
Un deuxième exemple, c'est celui de la succession
Another example, the succession of bird groups during the growth of a population which is managed following in the forest being regenerated from sowing to the aged forest. When the trees are less than 2 meters high, the forest is being regenerated and there are coppices, the bird species will be species nesting on the ground. When the trees are 3 meters high, other species will develop because they nest in the young trees and they will remain until the last stages of succession. Birds that nest in cavities need old trees to be able to nest and survive, so they only come at the last stage of the forest regeneration. And finally, a few species are typical of regeneration phases, very open forests with a few large trees, and these species are species which like to nest in open environments in large, big, isolated trees. Generally speaking, we observe that diversity in terms of number of species reaches its maximum level at the intermediate stage, except that it is not sufficient to count the number of species. We also need to consider the type of species, which depends on the stages. For instance, take a forest. Biological diversity is caused by the overlapping at different stages of different populations of species which are suited to a specific stage.
Différents au sein d'un massif forestier.
Because these stages will overlap, there will be a changing mosaic of habitats, changing because the stages are going to evolve. They're all submitted locally to the capacity to go backwards because of a climatic event, for instance, upsetting the process. And it is the interaction between the changing habitat mosaic in the forest and the traits of the species colonizing them, their niches, their competition with each other or their dispersal capacity that will determine biological diversity in that given forest.
Alors, dans un cycle sylvigénésique naturel
in
des forêts,
the normal
en général, en
forest cycle, in the absence of any upsetting factors, the pioneer, post-pioneer, mature, and terminal phases will alternate. In the terminal phases, very large trees will die, fall down. This means that there will be a hole left unoccupied in the forest, and regeneration will start in this open space, and the cycle starts all over again. But what about forests which are managed by man for wood production? In this case, we have a forest growing management cycle, and man will work for post-pioneer species of trees. And if we have post-pioneer species such as oak and other kinds of pioneer species, the pioneer species will be eliminated, and the shorter pioneer phase will be short-circuited. At the other end, the terminal phase is also eliminated because the trees are cut down long before they reach their the age at which they would naturally become old and die.
Si bien qu'on peut dire schématiquement,
therefore, in summary, one may say that forest growing imitates normal upsetting factors, except that the trees being cut down are exported, regeneration is accelerated, benefiting species that have a greater value, and the selection will select the most beautiful trees because those trees will then provide seeds to populate the forest. This leads to a number of consequences. First of all, the cycle is cut short. Some stages are lost, such as the initial stages and final stages. And therefore, also a number of species that match those stages are lost. And also these habits and strategies have an influence on the genetic diversity, because open spaces are or thinning counterbalance natural selection. And in managed forests, we have far less microhabitats, such as cavities, dead wood, or bark, becoming detached from the trunk, far less natural habitats because trees carrying microhabitats are eliminated because either they are not beautiful or too old, and therefore those animal species which need the microhabitats to survive and are typically forest species are less abundant in managed forests. In conclusion, one may say that forest biodiversity is not carved in stone. Biodiversity is something that changes over time during the forest succession process, depending on the stage of forest management or natural forest regeneration. But it is also influenced by forest management. Therefore, biodiversity should be taken into consideration in forest management with a two-stage strategy. First of all, protected area networks should be organized in order to preserve biodiversity, and also forest matrices should be managed in a sustainable way, meaning that outside of the protected area networks, forest management must reconcile wood production with the preservation of biodiversity and landscapes. Several things must be looked after. We must pay attention to ancient forests because they had been in existence for several centuries, and therefore they represent a reservoir of a species that would not survive anywhere else. Also, we must pay attention to species that are entirely forest species, the genetic diversity of the tree species, aged stages, because there are some forest species, dead wood and microhabitats, which are absolutely essential to preserve forest biodiversity.